It's Monday, April 12th, 2021, and the morning edition is live. On today's show, we examine the effects of bullying. Jazz Chisholm hits the first home run of the season, and we're taking you to Blackbeard's Tower. So let's start the morning off right.
Good morning, everyone. I'm LaDawn Davis.
Well, I couldn't get a good dream last night because of that thunderstorm. I'm Charles Fisher.
And Fisher, there was a fire out over there at Potter's Key. I don't know if you were able to get any information on that.
Well, Lloyd Allen is out there this morning. He'll have much more information. And I was surprised when he came to work this morning. Yeah, that a fire was out there at Potter's Key Dock. So how was your weekend? You look very nice.
It was pretty good. I had a good weekend.
Very restful.
Yeah. I know that the weather, you saw the weather out there this morning. I see a lot of debris when we're coming into the game.
The streets are wet, so be careful out there. A lot of debris in the street, even coming up here on Collins Avenue, a lot of debris out there. But it was a great weekend no matter what. The thunderstorm just came on us all of a sudden. Some of the debris right there, as we look on your screen from this morning out there on the street. So once again, if you're out there driving, please do so extreme caution and care. And what were your impression when you heard that boom, bang, bang? I thought my wife was rowing me again, but it wasn't. It was something else this time.
Because as a kid, you know, I was always afraid of thunder and lightning, so that was kind of crazy last evening.
They left all the windows open, closed the windows. I was scared that it was, I hear things just riding up and down the road, like trash can and this, I say hurricane in April. But then it was in a hurricane, but it was good.
I understand that you took the vaccine.
Yes, on Saturday, you know, on Friday, they sent out that media now can now go take the vaccine. So I went there Saturday morning. I must say the person instead, the volunteers are very professional. It is smooth. Sometimes you don't have to listen what people say or this and that. You just got to experience things for yourself. So I went there, took the vaccine on Saturday. You know, my little chicken arm, it got a little sore, but I'm feeling much better now. Had a little slight headache here and there, but it was perfect. I'm feeling quite good.
So when we see you in the corner stuttering and twittering and doing the hippie jibbies,
that will not be the case. Everything went by pretty good.
And I know the weather. We're gonna have some bad weather for the remainder of the week. But Lloyd Allen is out there.
Let's check with Lloyd. He's busy on the streets this morning as the persons get out there after that thunderstorm last night. Good morning, Lloyd.
The traffic report is sponsored by Bahamas First. First in insurance, today, tomorrow.
Well, good morning, LaDawn and Fisher, and good morning, Bahamas. A sad start to the morning for many vendors here in the Potter's Key Dock, as overnight, several of those vendors experienced a loss from a fire, several of those stalls destroyed, along with several of the fishing vessels in the area. Now, later on, we're going to speak with the Vendors Association that will add more insight as to what exactly happened and the level of damage experienced at this time. As it relates to traffic in this area, persons coming out to the mail boat should be able to do so without much obstruction, as well as those using the Eastern Paradise Island Bridge. That's fully functional. East Bay Street as well is open for use for the public. And we also want to remind persons in other parts of the capital that some challenges may exist as a result of that storm last night. This morning, we're also speaking with Corporal Christopher Wimps from the Royal Bahamas Police Force Traffic Division, giving us an update on traffic developments over the weekend period.
Good morning, Lloyd. Good morning, Mahabas. We're happy to report that we had no traffic accident reported to the police last night. However, in a total of 72 hours, we had a total of 18 accidents, 17 of which were accident with minor damages, one with injury. At this time, we have 9 hospitalized victims as a result of those accidents.
And Officer Wimps, I know, of course, overnight, those increased winds and rain may have created some challenges around the capital and country. And so give us an update or an advisory for motorists as they use the streets today.
Yes. On my way traversing here this morning, I made a sweep of the western side on northwest side of Nassau to come here. Motoring public, be aware, be advised that you will please expect some delays as a result of fallen trees and branches in those areas. Be aware that in the area of Sanders Beach, Goodman's Bay area, we have the road straight up with sand. The road is loaded with sand. So we want to ask persons, this is the time to make sure you have good tires, good brakes. We ask the persons to drive with their lights kind of on the mid on, based on the murky weather. So all these things, we want to keep people safe while traversing to the destination. Now, as a result of this fire last night, we want to remind persons if they don't have to come into the dock area as relates to dropping off or picking up packages, please, we don't need any more spectators out here. It's around 7 o'clock in the morning and we have already have about 100 persons just stopping by, just direct, you know, hindering the flat traffic just a bit. So we don't need no added stuff. Please, trust what you see on WhatsApp. Yes, it was a fire last night. Thankfully, no one was hurt. We hope and we're praying that everybody's, you know, but at this time, please avoid the bridge if you have to.
And so, of course, later on in the newscast, we're going to speak with a representative from the Vendors Association who can add some more insight as to what may have happened last night, as well as the level of loss experienced by many of those vendors. Reporting here from Potter's Key Dock, LaDawn and Fisher, back to you guys in studio.
Thanks a lot, Lord. As you can see, the streets are still wet. We are waking up to 72 degrees this morning. Wind south at 9 miles per hour. Humidity 93%. A cold front along with an upper level trough will move southeastward through the Bahamas today. Central and southeast Bahamas cloudy to overcast and breezy with scattered showers and isolated thunderstorms becoming heavy at times, becoming partly sunny, cool and breezy after the front passes. Partly cloudy and cool tonight. Daytime high temperatures 82. Overnight will be 66. As we look into our extended forecast on Tuesday, 81 in the day, 68 at night. Mostly cloudy with a thunderstorm expected. Wednesday and Thursday, 80 and 81. Nice sunshine back in the air. Friday and Saturday, basically the same.
Let's take a look now at stories making news headlines.
22 new cases of COVID-19 reported by the Ministry of Health in its latest release. 19 of those cases are here in New Providence and 3 over in Grand Bahama, bringing the total count nationwide to 9,439. The new cases comprise of 14 women and 8 men. 2 of those cases in New Providence have a travel history within the last 14 days. There are 41 hospitalizations, 2 individuals detained in the intensive care unit, and 39 listed as moderately ill. There are 329 active cases and new recoveries, with that total remaining at 8,865. 189 COVID-19 deaths are on record. Persons 50 and over, along with restaurant and retail workers, can now begin making appointments to receive the COVID-19 vaccine. Persons with disabilities and their caregivers on New Providence have also been added to the vaccination list. Those individuals can book appointments starting today at the Stapleton School vaccination site on Dolphin Drive. Other vaccination sites are the Kendall G. Isaacs National Gymnasium, Loyola Hall on Gladstone Road, the Church of God of Prophecies, East Street Tabernacle, Bahama Cable Beach, the Atlantis Paradise Island Resort, and the Susan J. Wallace Community Center in Grand Bahama. You can log on to thevax.gov.bs to book your vaccination appointment. Health officials confirming that more than 15,000 residents on New Providence, Grand Bahama, and Eleuther have already received the first dose of the AstraZeneca COVID-19 vaccine. And while many of them may want to travel, they will still be required to present a negative COVID-19 test.
As it relates to the movement of the restriction to have to test, certainly I believe considerations can be made along the lines of once persons are fully vaccinated, but we are certainly not, there as yet. But as we continue to move forward with our vaccination campaign, I anticipate that we will be in a position to review, what the guidance is from countries such as the U.S., the CDC, and others, the World Health Organization, as it relates to travelers not having to test. But certainly, where we are currently, those measures will need to remain in place.
Police Commissioner Paul Rose sending a stern warning to those involved in the falsification of COVID-19 tests after several people were charged and arraigned in the magistrate's court for obtaining fake tests in the last week. Commissioner Rose is urging the public to follow the correct procedures when obtaining such documentation for travel and other purposes in an effort to avoid prosecution and keep their families safe. Prime Minister, the Most Honorable Dr. Hubert Minnis will lead debate on the landmark Prospect Land Development Resolution when the House of Assembly proceedings resume at 10 o'clock this morning. This will allow government to construct an upscale housing subdivision for young professionals between 18 and 45 years old on prime land in Western New Providence. You can watch live on Parliamentary Channel 420 or tune in on the Bahamas Radio Network. Governor General His Excellency the Most Honorable Cornelius Smith will head a list of Bahamians and residents signing an official book of condolences on the passing of His Royal Highness Prince Philip, Duke of Edinburgh. His Excellency will sign the book at 9:05 this morning at the temporary offices of the Governor General at 1 Montague Place on East Bay Street. Prime Minister, the Most Honorable Dr. Hubert Minnis will then sign the book, followed by the Chief Justice, members of the Cabinet, and other officials of state. Members of the public will be able to sign the book this Wednesday, April 14th, and Thursday, April 15th, between 9 a.m. and 5 p.m. Members of the Healthy Caribbean Coalition are campaigning and raising awareness for the addition of front-of-packaging nutritional labels. It's all a part of a collaboration between the Pan-American Health Organization, UNICEF, and the Health Group. This year, CARICOM countries will vote on whether to adopt the final draft of the regional standard for specification for labeling of prepackaged goods.
Been shown, so like in countries like Chile, they have those front packages, and I've already been there myself and actually seen these packages. And then when you see them, you kind of want, you know, say, I don't want to have that, it's too much sugar in it. So yes, it does work. There's data behind all of this, so we know that the front of packaging labels do work.
Ronald Chisholm hitting his first home run of the season over the weekend for the Miami Marlins. The rookie second baseman took a Jake DeGrom 100-mile fastball over the fence for a solo shot on Saturday as the Marlins shut out the New York Mets 3-0.
Well, I went in there, and a lot of people were saying, like, it's an angry 100. It gets on you. And after I took the first pitch, I was just like, ooh, it didn't really get on me like I was expecting how everybody else said. And then I got a 0-1 fastball, and I was early. So after I was early, I was just thinking that he was thinking the same way I was thinking, like, okay, he's early on my fastball. So since he's so far up front, I'm going to throw off-speed now. So I was looking for an off-speed pitch, and he threw me a fastball up, and I just reacted to it, got my hands above the ball, and, yeah, it was a homer.
And when we come back, we take a look at the effects of bullying. You're watching The Morning Edition.
At BPL, we are building for better, and that starts with improving customer relations for every single customer. Whether it's your home or business, big or small, we want you to know that you are important to us and that providing you with efficient and reliable energy is our business. Through increased efficiency and our hedging strategy, we've been able to decrease your bill significantly, a much welcome relief in these trying times.
I pay close attention to my BPL bill, and I've noticed a continual decline since July of last year. I'm so happy I can open my bill and know that it's steadily becoming more manageable.
As an entrepreneur, I've seen my electricity bills for home and business go down. This is amazing because now more than ever, it gives businesses and everyone the break they need to not only survive, but to succeed.
At BPL, we're proud of the early success of our strategic plan, and we look forward to consolidating the gains we've made. With more improvements on the way, we are continuing to build for a better future for all of us.
Autism is a complex developmental condition that involves persistent challenges in social interaction, speech, and nonverbal communication, and restricted repetitive behaviors. Joining us live here on the Morning Edition to give more insight on the signs of the disorder is pediatric consultant at the Princess Margaret Hospital, Dr. Deshaun Saunders. Dr. Saunders, welcome to the Morning Edition.
Good morning. Thanks for having me.
So, Dr. Saunders, tell us a little bit about what is actually autism.
So you kind of coined it. Autism is a developmental disorder. It affects children usually between the ages of 2 to 3 years of age. It can be diagnosed as early as 18 months. And these children, they present with social communication and restrictive behaviors. So when we expand that a little bit more, these are kids that may give limited eye contact. They may be nonverbal, meaning they may not be able to talk. Or if they do talk, they're able to just identify objects, or they would be repetitive. So meaning that if they were to watch TV programs, they can sing the alphabet, they can sing numbers, but they're not able to request.
What are actually some of the different spectrums for autism?
So there are different spectrums, but in 2005, they actually umbrellaed it to autism spectrum disorder, but you have Asperger's, which would be the higher end, and so these kids are able to function. They're also called gifted, but they have social impairment. And then you have pervasive developmental disorder, and these are kids that may have severe challenges, so they may not be able to talk, they may not be able to have behavioral issues, but everything is coined into autism.
And what do you think is actually causing an increase in autism cases here in the Bahamas?
So I wouldn't say that there's an increase in cases. The CDC has indicated that 1 in 59 children are being diagnosed with autism yearly. However, I think that more awareness, the fact that more pediatricians and clinicians are able to identify the signs and symptoms of autism, and even parents are now more aware that if their kid is not talking, kids are acting abnormal, hey, something is going on. So I think it's more in terms of awareness and diagnosis, the reason why we're seeing an increasing number.
Dr. Saunders, thank you so much for joining us here on the Morning Edition, and all the best to you and your team as you continue to educate Bahamians on autism.
Thank you so much for having me.
Dozens of high school students and adults turned out to the Hope Center recently to get some first-hand information on how to deal with all forms of bullying. The Stop the Bullying seminar is a partnership with a student-focused organization. Organizer and founder of the Hope Center, Dr. Carlos Reed, says some 50 students were invited to the Stop the Bullying seminar, but due to the COVID-19 pandemic, those numbers dwindled. Reed hopes the message given would not only be considered by education officials, but attract more young people and Bahamians to the campaign.
There are more people that commit suicide because they're being bullied. You know, ironically, my daughter, not until she graduated from school, I knew that she was being bullied. This is something that most parents can't detect, but they destroy the social adaptability of a lot of our young people. So we figure that it needs to be addressed. It needs to be addressed not just in a setting like this, but I would like to advocate that our government include bullying inside our schools, include subjects of how to deal with bullying, what can you do if you're being bullied, also conflict resolution and anger management. We say that the school is supposed to prepare kids for life when they come out of school, but are we preparing them? We pay a lot of attention to subjects in our curriculum that some of our kids would never use.
We now go back to our Lloyd Allen on that fire last night at Port of Ski. Lloyd?
Well, it's a developing scene still here at Port of Ski Dock, where just a few hours ago, it was reported that a major fire happened here, destroying several vendors' stalls along with their property. This morning, we're joined by the Bahamas Vendors and Allied Dock Association. And we're speaking with the Secretary General, Gregory Bowles. Mr. Bowles, again, this is still a very ripe situation. Talk to us about when you first heard about these details.
Well, I mean, I really have no way to explain how I felt at that point in time when I first heard about it, you know. And right now, the vendors out here, we've been going through a lot lately. For the past 3 years, we've been going through the shooting incident, the parking incident, the pandemic, and all this. I don't know how they're going to make it. I don't know how they're going to make it.
Now, according to initial reports, we know that about 7 stalls were damaged along with 2 fishing vessels. Have you spoken with any of the proprietors as yet?
No, I haven't spoken. I spoke to one of our former president's wife, and she's just thankful that no one was injured, And he, right now, our former president, he's not here right now. He's out to sea. One of his fishing boat was just totally destroyed, along with his stall.
Now, I know that, again, police are still putting together their report on exactly what happened. Even as we surveyed the site, we saw several gas tanks that likely exploded during that fire. Any major challenges that you recall that would have happened last night?
The only major challenge, I think, in my opinion, if the fire branch had responded more quickly, I think they could have probably saved a few more stalls. You know, because I was out there for like about 45 minutes before I saw the first fire engine. You know, so it really amazed me to see why it took so long for a response from the fire department. No offense to them, but you know, I don't know what was the hold up in getting a response from the fire department.
Now, we know, of course, around the island, there was increased winds and many challenges for many persons inland. But, of course, here, those winds couldn't have contributed positively to minimizing this fire.
No. I think the winds contributed significantly to the fire. Because as I stood up and watched, the wind is continuously blowing the fire this way. So it contributed considerably. And I think it has to do a lot with the weather that came down last night.
Yeah. Well, of course, this is a developing story. ZNS News will be on the scene getting more details for you as it becomes available. Fisher and LaDawn, back to you guys in studio.
Thanks a lot, Lloyd. And as we head to the break, we take a look back at the day in Bahamian history. On April 12, 1930, the Public Works Department completed plans for the reconstruction of Government House. Officials proposed to alter the exterior of the building as well as improve the interior. The building, erected in 1912, suffered hurricane damage in 1929. Also on April 12, 1990, Hubert Ingraham was elected Free National Movement Leader of Parliamentary Business in the House of Assembly. He made his maiden speech at a rally of deliverance on Arambilly Park 12 days later.
ZNS is everywhere you are when you download the new ZNS app. Watch our live channel to keep up with what's going on in the nation. News updates, we've got you covered. Tune into our radio stations with just a swipe. On the road, on the go, we're here with you. Available for download on the App Store and the Google Play Store.
The outdoor college track and field season continuing over the weekend. Sasha Rells from All Raw is breaking another school record in the Mask Rider Open in Texas. Rells at the class off the field in the women's 100-meter hurdles, winning in 13.30 seconds, erasing her old mark of 13.39. Over in Miami at the Hurricane Alumni Invitational, Xavier Coakley running on his home track. He would also take the win, equaling his personal best of 13.81 seconds. Our college baseball players continuing to use the long ball. Wade Weinberger hit his 40th home run of the season for Bryan College on Friday. It was a grand salami and helped his team to a doubleheader sweep over St. Andrews University. B.J. Murray also finding the stands over the weekend for the Florida Atlantic Owls. He actually had two home runs as the Owls lost 2 of 3 to Old Dominion. Anaraj Anu making the most of his appearance on the SEC network for the Kentucky Wildcats. He had a no-doubt home run, which actually landed on the girls' softball field. Kentucky was able to salvage a win after losing the first two games of the series to LSU. And Texas Paramount Basin baseball team brought Perron Burrows on as pinch hitter on Saturday, and he made the most of his opportunity with a two-run home run in the eighth inning, and that was the difference in the game, with the Falcons winning 7-5 over Oklahoma Christian. And more baseball, Ellis Hanna playing a big role for Indiana State on Sunday. He had a pinch hit run home run in the ninth inning to send the game into the extra inning with Illinois State. Indiana State won the game in extra innings 8-7. And after the break, we are heading to Blackbeard's Tower.
What I love love most about working for the Bahamas Tonight is that we don't only focus on New Providence. We cover the entire Bahamas. We have a team here in the Northern Bahamas that is ready to bring you the stories, the people, and the news that matter to you. From point A to Z, from covering hurricanes to elections and everything in between.
There's been a lot of public discussion about the safety of COVID-19 vaccines. Here are some of the facts. Common side effects from the COVID-19 vaccine are usually mild and temporary. These can include a sore arm and a fever. More serious side effects are possible, but extremely rare. All COVID-19 vaccines undergo vigorous clinical trials before they are put into use, and they are regularly reassessed. Scientists are constantly monitoring the data and reports to ensure that vaccines are safe and cause no health risk. Remember that you are far more likely to experience severe complications or death associated with COVID-19 than the vaccine itself. As you make your decision to get vaccinated, be sure that you are armed with the facts.
This message has been brought to you by the Government of the Bahamas in conjunction with the Broadcasting Corporation of the Bahamas.
Probably at a teachable moment, the infamous historic figure Blackbeard is arguably the most aggressive buccaneer to have ever sailed the seas. In this interesting feature, Lloyd Allen explores the remnants of what is believed to be the site of Blackbeard's Tower in eastern New Providence.
He's that infamous pirate that most of us have read about in our history books. And during this time, most persons were afraid of him. Yes, it's Blackbeard. And today, join me as I take the trek leading all the way to Blackbeard's Tower in eastern New Providence. And it begins right here, Blackbeard's Tower.
It was more than 300 years ago when Edward Teach, also known as Blackbeard, controlled the high seas and terrorized travelers, including many voyaging here to Nassau. His former citadel, nicknamed Blackbeard's Tower, now sits tucked away at Blackbeard's Terrace. But how do you get there? Heading east, you'd pass the Old St. Anne Cemetery. About 200 feet to the right, you'll find Blackbeard's Terrace. From there, it's all the way uphill, past a few homes, and the old structure is blanketed behind years of shrubbery and clouded in mystery. Now, according to officials from the Bahamas Antiquities Monuments and Museums Corporation, they believe the tower was built in the early 1700s and was used as a lookout for vessels coming to New Providence from the east, with content ripe for the taking by Blackbeard and his cronies. But back to the tower. It offers a nearly 360-degree view of the island with inscriptions throughout its interior, likely from many visitors over the years. There's even signs of a restoration likely taking place over the past 50 years. But despite those efforts, the interior remains in a dilapidated state. There are signs of a once-functional staircase, at least two levels built into the structure, and an eerie feeling of some swashbuckling in the air. Listed as one of the 10 historic sites around the capital, Blackbeard's Tower remains a must-see for both visitors and locals.
Some good information there, Fisher. I didn't know that that was there.
Every day, didn't live right here in Nassau, didn't even know that was there. Ride past stuff. Now and again.
Antiquities monuments, they always give you some interesting artifacts on history back in the day when we were probably not even considered a thought yet, you know. And be sure to stay tuned into the ZNS Network for news as it happens, TV and radio updates throughout the day. Then you can tune into Live at 5, the Northern Edition, and the Bahamas Tonight at 7. And that's a wrap for us this morning for the entire team. I'm LaDawn Davis.
Have a great day, everybody.
Have a good morning.